Welcome back, listeners, to another episode of Tech Talk.
I'm Roy for the Tech.
And I'm Earl for the Talk.
So, it's been a month or more since we've last recorded anything, so sorry for that, listeners, but a lot of tech stuff has happened during our absence. So, you know what that means? It's Earl and Roy giving their thoughts on announced products. So, want to get started on it?
Yeah, of course I want to get started. All right, I can tell you this, like, with everything that's been happening lately, I'm kind of glad that we can get back to doing the podcast because it's a nice change of pace to just sit back, relax, talk about some technology for a while instead of stressing over, you know, finals, you know, as well as the hackathon we joined, which we won't be talking about this episode.
Yeah. I just have to say the hackathon, it was great, but it was really stressful.
Yep.
I mean, in the end, we still persevered and, you know, at least got into the top 20, but other than that...
it was pretty hard. It was pretty hard.
Yeah. Let's just talk tech.
Yeah, let's just talk tech. All right, so opening up the banter section, we're actually going to talk about GCash again. This time, the reason we're talking about GCash is because of their new feature. Rather, it's not really their new feature, but... it's a feature in Steam which allows you to use GCash to pay for your games now, which is a real like innovation. At least it's a real convenience.
It's more convenient because before, if you wanted to, you know, buy Steam credits,
you had to go
to GCash, buy a virtual gift card, and then GCash will send the gift card code to you, and then you'll have to manually enter that said gift card code, and then it will now be credited to your account. Now you can do it directly as if you're, you know, using PayPal or a credit card.
Technically, it's still an innovation because it's an innovation to convenience. I'm just kidding. All right, just kidding. All right. So a good thing about this new feature is now, as Roy mentioned before, now it's a lot more convenient to buy your games off of Steam. You just directly using GCash without having to go through this step or that step. Or having to just wait for the code, because that's a hassle, dude. That is just... Yeah, I know it takes a split, like, it doesn't take as long, but still, like, with this feature, it'll only take, like, a few seconds as opposed to a couple minutes.
Yeah. Because I know people who would get irritated that the message to get their gift card code takes a few seconds longer than they would expect it to.
Yep, or sometimes even minutes, knowing GCash, because... I sent my application out and I'm still not upgraded. My account's still not upgraded.
I really think you should resubmit your application
again. I resubmitted it twice and twice it expired. That means they never checked it.
Huh.
Yeah, anyway, moving on. So what does this mean for the future? Well, now that we can, well, of course, us as Filipinos, like, not everyone has access to a credit card. Not everyone has access to a debit card. Most of us usually rely on things like Paymaya, GCash, or even like PayPal. If you're one of
because
those.
The barrier of entry is low.
Mm-hmm. Because the barrier of entry is low.
Essentially, all you really need is just load some money into it, and you're good to go.
Yep, it's essentially just a virtual wallet that allows you to shop online. And
it is a virtual wallet.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I said it's essentially a virtual wallet. That's what it is. So it's a good thing now that at least now with Steam implementing GCash into their payment methods, hopefully we'll start to see that more in the future. Like for example, it's not just Steam. Maybe we'll see it in Epic Games, because again, they're a direct competitor or something like that.
Just don't spend all of your GCash, you know.
Yeah, just don't spend
money into it.
Yeah, just all right. Especially about the Steam sales, like regarding the Steam summer sale that happened, like, I think a month ago. I know it's tempting to keep buying the games because they're so cheap and they're a steal because of the price. But you gotta be mindful of your spending because, all right, time for a personal story time, Roy. All right, just a minute, just for a personal story. Would you like to hear?
All right.
Okay, Roy. So
this sounds juicy. So
it is. All right, it's very juicy. So, all right, 2 years ago, when it was grade 12, the world was well and there was no quarantine. We could go outside and enjoy our marugame udon. There was the Steam, and we just finished our PBL that time. Remember? Like our grade 12 Bayaral. All right, so
yeah,
moving. All right, so after it was done, I had we had all felt really relieved, but it was essentially the same time that the Steam sale dropped, which was in April, if I remember. Yeah, it was April. It was around April, if I remember. A good thing to remember about this is that the Steam sale had a lot of games that I've wanted on sale. Two of them was Metro Exodus and Metro Last Light. Both of them were the... Oh, wait, not Metro Exodus.
Redux?
Yeah, Metro the Redux, Redux versions. And Metro Last Light Redux, yes. Both of them were Redux version. And a bunch of other games, like Yakuza 0, Yakuza Kiwami, Enter the Gungeon, Binding of Isaac. You know those games. Basically, you know a lot of games I've wanted, all right? Now, it was a Steam sale, and I just so happened to have my debit card next to me.
Right? I think I know where this is going.
Yep, you know exactly where it's going. So first, I started buying off the Metro series, which cost me... It was pretty cheap. Like, it was around... All right, both games were priced at 200, so 400 down the drain. And soon, I was buying Binding of Isaac. I was buying other games. And then soon enough, when I looked at my balance, how much I drained, 5,000 went down the drain, but I ended up getting I ended up getting 25 plus games for it.
Oh my god. Yeah, splurging it all on games.
I can tell.
You know, I think I'm lucky that I don't really bother with Steam sales that much.
I can tell you, man, it just awakens something within your monkey brain. Like your primate brain says, oh, I don't want to miss opportunity because I'll have to wait months for opportunity to arrive again. There's just something about the green number with the percent off of it, man. Like with the percent next to it. All right,
66%.
I guess that should be. Speaking of monkey brain, and speaking of Steam, actually, this is a good way to segue into our tech section. So we're gonna talk about the Steam Deck, the recently arrived Steam Deck. All right.
Recent news with quotation marks.
Yep. So the thing about the Steam Deck is that it's the new handheld on the block, not really a direct competitor, but it's another add-on to the handheld market if you're into that. And the good thing about the Steam Deck is that it's not really like the Switch, where it's a handheld console. Instead, it's a portable gaming PC. Like, wow.
It has a controller and it's a PC. Wow.
You know, it's a good thing that tech companies are always thinking of convenience and portability nowadays, because if they hadn't thought about that, then we would not have the handheld vacuum cleaner. Alright?
Alright. Or the robot vacuum cleaner.
Or the robot.
It's also has something to do with space. Mm-hmm. It's a good thing because if you're living in an apartment...
Yeah, if you don't have
and you only have space for a laptop, but you already have a laptop, and you can't really splurge on an expensive gaming laptop,
or even a Steam PC, Deck. Man.
Yeah, the Steam Deck or even the Switch, if you want, is a really good value, a really good proposition.
Mm-hmm. And next to the Steam Deck, of course, is the Switch OLED. I almost forgot about it. All right.
We're not talking about the Switch regular version, nor the Switch Lite. We're talking about the Switch OLED version.
Yep, the Switch OLED is supposedly the better version of the base Nintendo Switch. It's the new version of a Nintendo Switch, but instead of using a LED screen, it uses an OLED display. An OLED display is the same.
Think of it as like a small refresh, really.
Mm-hmm. It's just a...
Not as a brand new, redefined model.
I would prefer...
It's just a refresh.
Yeah, you just call it a slight overhaul to the original. It doesn't really do anything that much new, but it's still pretty nice. It's nice to have as a novelty.
Yeah, from a 6.2-inch LCD, it's now a 7-inch OLED. Wow.
Wow, yeah, and it has better speakers now and a better kickstand. So do with that what you will.
And now the dock, the Nintendo Switch dock, now comes with a dedicated... Ethernet port. Wow.
Future, bro. It has an
future.
Ethernet. It has an Ethernet cord. We're just the future, man. Right? We're in the future. Right? All right. So moving forward, now we're gonna talk about the Steam Deck. All right. All right. Mm-hmm. We're not trying to compare the Switch to the Steam Deck because the Steam Deck is a portable gaming PC as advertised, and the Switch is a handheld console. Comparing both would kind of be unfair,
Because it would be kind of like, oh, I'm comparing my PS5 to my Xiaomi phone.
Yeah, like it's not a fair comparison to make. All right, so
it's like saying, oh, they both can play Genshin, but is it the same experience?
Exactly. All right, so now we're gonna talk about the real big boy, the bulky black absolute unit of a handheld, which is the Steam Deck. All right, all you need to know about the Steam Deck is it's Valve's version of a Nintendo Switch, but rather, I'm not even gonna call it that, since that really isn't what it is. But it's just to give you an idea. It is Valve's version of a handheld. There we go. That's a better way of explaining it. And it's advertised as a portable gaming PC, which means it's a little bigger. Actually, no, it's just bigger than the Nintendo Switch, but it's a lot more powerful. Like, it's a legit gaming PC that they turned into a handheld. And this is Valve. Like, it's classified as Valve hardware, which I'm really like. I hope. Like, they have...
Yeah, like, from Valve's controllers, now we have an actual console.
Yeah, I really hope
that... Which is nice.
Well, I mean, this thing is the new thing around, like, the new kid on the box. So, I assume it's gonna have, like, at least 2 or 3 years of support before, like, they have to move on to something else. But it could even go longer than that, because, like...
Yeah, because remember, the Switch is now entering its fourth year?
Mm-mm-mm. Yeah.
So, yeah, without any major hardware refreshes, so... Yeah, give or take, 3 to 6 years.
All right, so the Steam Deck will begin shipping in December of 2021. So anyone who wants to pre-order, which hopefully you can, or you find a website that you can pre-order, like, you have until then to, like, pre-order it, because it officially launches on December of 2021. And I can tell you this, if you're one of the people that want to buy it on release date, good luck. May the stars...
Yeah, it'll just be like the PS5 and the Xbox Series version.
May the stars align to help you on your journey, traveler. Alright? Because I can tell you that right now, it's almost sold out. I say almost, because
remember, some models are shipping not on December 2021 anymore.
Yep.
It's already early 2022.
Yep, because of the...
No definite month on that 2022,
yep,
by
it's
the
just
way.
An estimate of what the Valve says. Like, this is from an official report from them. That says, like, okay. Their estimate is that it might release in December of 2021. But we all know, like, with the quarantine and the chip shortage, it might be rolled back for some models. But let's not think of that. Instead, let's focus on the fun system, like the new shiny, shiny piece of technology. All right,
it do be the shiny.
All right, so we've explained what the Steam Deck is, but all right, it's a portable gaming PC. It's bigger than the Switch. Like, it's a lot bulkier and a little weightier. But what makes it so different? Everyone wants to know what you can do with it. Well, the good news is, what you can do with the Steam Deck. Well, then the reason we can't really compare it to the Nintendo Switch is because it does a lot of things. Remember,
yeah, for one, it plays a lot of PC games on the current Steam Shop.
Yep. A good thing about the Steam Deck is that you have your entire Steam library with you on the go, so long as you have internet.
Yeah. I mean, look at the promotional images. You see Control,
The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt, Doom Eternal, Binding of Isaac Rebirth, Super Meat Boy, and even Horizon Zero Dawn.
But Earl, I want to ask something.
Yes?
Can it efficiently run Train Sim World 2?
Oh, absolutely. David, like, Linus showed off, like, in one of his videos. It may not even be Linus's videos, but what there was a video of Valve, like, when they were showing it off. Like, they showed it running Microsoft Flight Sim. All right, so
let's go. That's my kind of game.
So do
let's
with that
go.
What you will. All right. So if it's a train sim, expect that this baby can handle it. All right. So this is exactly why the Steam Deck is sold out. Because imagine if you play on PC, primarily on PC, and you have Steam, and you have like hundreds of games that you've played, and pretty much, okay, let's be honest, you have hundreds of games in your library, but have you really played all of them?
Don't call me out.
All right. So, yeah, you have hundreds of games essentially at your disposal, like on the go with the Steam Deck. You have your whole Steam library, and it doesn't stop there. Remember, this is a portable gaming PC. So that means that you can use it as a like a laptop. It's a legit portable gaming PC. That means you're not limited to just Steam. You can play.
Looking at their tech specs, they're estimating with their 40 watt hour battery around 2 to 8 hours of games.
Yep. If it's here's a good thing about it. If it's a graphically intensive game like Doom Eternal, it can run it with pretty good graphics, like pretty high, like not the highest, but it's high enough that it looks great, right?
Yeah. It will kill the battery, but it seems like a good trade-off.
Yeah, but think of it this way: with like the Nintendo Switch, if you play for like 2 hours straight, like on the handheld version, you're going to need to charge it at some point, all right? And the Nintendo Switch's graphics, like honestly, like it's not a fair comparison again because this is like console. Like, even with, like, the graphics being, you know, like, pretty okay, pretty decent. Yeah.
I mean, we're talking about, in the Switch at least, we're talking about a NVIDIA Tegra processor that's been used on, like, phones and tablets from 5 years ago.
Yeah, exactly. But the fact that, it, like, for 2 hours straight of just straight gameplay before you need to charge, that's pretty good enough.
Yeah, pretty good.
But so this is what makes the Steam Deck so impressive, though. Like with high graphics, you could keep playing for 2 hours straight, despite the strain, the obvious strain on the CPU and GPU. You can play it for 2 hours straight before you need to charge it. And speaking of, you know what? Honestly,
speaking of what is it?
Speaking of convenience and honestly, strain. The Steam Deck, if you don't know. Like, just to flex a little bit, and honestly, I have a feeling Valve did this in direct response to Nintendo Switch, but again, you didn't hear that from us, and you didn't hear that from this podcast, alright?
Alright. Remember, we're not sponsored in any way.
Yeah, we're not sponsored anyway, nor are we biased. We're just reporting about what we actually see, or actually what's known about these technologies, these consoles, these, like, is Steam Deck really a console? I love regarding these technologies.
Just say it is kind of.
But the point is, we're just reporting what we know, like the current knowledge known about both systems. All right.
Yeah.
So a good thing about the Steam that voice cracked though. All right. So what's known about the Steam Deck is that honestly, you can dock it to your monitor like you can the Switch. Like you can dock it onto your TV or your monitor.
Oh yeah, yeah. Like I've seen some promotional images where you just connect it to your monitor and it functions like a mobile PC.
Yeah,
it is a mobile PC.
It's a portable gaming PC, and that's just the icing on the cake. You could legit connect this to a monitor, to a keyboard and mouse, and use it like a normal gaming PC.
I'm sure some people know this. On select Samsung and Huawei phones, if you connect your phone to a monitor, you will automatically go to the desktop mode of that phone. So in a way, your phone has a mini PC in there. So imagine the same thing with the Steam Deck.
Yep, but except it's a lot more powerful. It's just a lot more powerful. So that means that, for example, if for some reason you want to play Sushi Cat, or you want to play Overcooked 2 with your friend, and you know, you don't feel comfortable sharing like the weird controls on like the Steam Deck, you could connect it to the PC, or you can connect it to like your friend's monitor.
Yeah, your monitor.
And connect two controllers on it, and then like, you can just play. Like you can just play. That's it. Simple. It's just plug and play. Simple as that. All right. Yeah. So now we've talked about what the Steam Deck can do, but what's under the hood? All right. Let's get into some more technical stuff. All right. But before that, speaking of technical stuff, we're gonna talk about how much it costs first. All right. It's all well and good, but how much does this actually cost, alright? Since,
let me guess, starting at $399 USD.
Yep.
The same as the OLED Switch.
It's actually right on the money. No pun intended. It's actually, the base model is $399 for the 64GB version, alright? Hold on, how much is that in pesos actually? I'll do some quick conversion here, so USD to PHP, which is 20,122 pesos and 77 centavos, alright?
Oh, I stand corrected. It's the OLED Switch is not $400, it's $350.
We're not talking about the OLED Switch. We're talking about the Steam Deck.
No, I said earlier the same price as the Switch OLED, but I stand corrected. It's $50 cheaper.
Yep. So the Steam OLED, honestly, it's not as bad as people.
It's not as bad, but it's not as bad as people say it is. It's just that if you're an existing Switch owner, you really don't need it.
Yeah, and it doesn't really do anything that much new. Like, sure, it has a slightly better display. It has a better kickstand and speakers, but
what we're essentially saying is that the OLED Switch is just for the new customers.
Yeah, it's
the newcomers to the Switch ecosystem.
Yeah, it's for the.
It's not really meant for
the,
you know.
Or the Nintendo enthusiasts and collectors. You know, it's just really just for novelty. If you're buying it at that point.
Yeah. If you just like with a lot of things, ask yourself this question: do I need it?
Yeah, exactly. So back to the Steam Deck. So $399 for the 64-gigabyte version, which equates to 20,000 pesos. You can get the 529 version of the Steam Deck, which is 256 gigabytes. So hold on, how much is that in pesos? So 529 USD to PHP is actually, hold on, that's 39, not 29. That's 26,000. So for 6,000 pesos more, you're essentially getting 200 GB more of storage, essentially.
Yeah.
And then there's the 649 version of the Steam Deck, which honestly is the sold out version because everyone bought it immediately when it became available, like they pre-ordered it, which is at 512 gigabytes.
I mean, it's a good deal.
Yeah,
it's a good deal if you think about it.
It's just a great deal in general, dude. Like, for $649, you can get a portable gaming PC with 512 gigabytes of storage. That's a lot. And that is
NVMe SSD.
Oh.
Mind you.
Mm-hmm. Looking at the spec sheet, it's NVMe SSD for the 256GB version and 512GB version. But for the 64GB version, it uses eMMC, which, Roy, can you explain exactly, like, the problem with eMMC?
It's slower, and I'm talking about for phones, at least. eMMC, has a reputation for slowing down after a few years. So if your Android phone starts to slow down after a few years and it's using eMMC, it's probably the reason why.
Yep, because eMMC is just with the technology itself. eMMC is known to degrade over time because of wear and tear and just how much.
But then again, it's probably why MMV, your mileage may vary, because the Switch, if I recall correctly, uses eMMC as well, and I don't notice any much slowdown in day-to-day life.
I see. Right, so...
Yeah.
Alright, just in case I didn't mention it, the 512GB version of the Switch costs... the Steam Deck costs...
$650, yeah, you already said it.
No, the 649, like the 512GB version costs $649, which equates to 32,000 pesos.
Yeah.
Let's call it 33 because it's 32,734 pesos exactly, but let's just call it 33K.
Yeah, let's put some, you know, leeway onto it.
Yep, so it's 30. So, okay. So, to recap, the 399 version equates to around 22,000, like 22,000 pesos. The 529 one equates to around 27. 649 one equates to around 33K. But here's the thing: if you want the 256GB version, 512GB version, you better get those pre-orders in, because from what I know, like the official website that Steam put up for it, the 256GB version and 512GB version are sold out, and the 64GB version, if I remember, are still available.
And
speaking of storage, did you know that you can aside from the SSDs that are built into the systems themselves, you can increase your storage by using micro SD cards?
Yeah, but same as the Switch.
I love that segue though. Alright, so the problem with the micro SD card, and it's actually like stated like before you buy the console, is that if you're gonna increase the storage space with a micro SD card, be wary that it won't be as fast as the SSD for obvious reasons.
I mean, obviously.
Yep. So like, if you have it, don't start complaining why some of your games don't load as fast. Because if it's not downloaded onto the SSD, of course it's gonna take a little longer. right?
Yeah.
So
main memory, secondary memory.
So now moving on to the Steam Deck specs. Oh, the specs, all right. For the CPU, it is rocking an AMD Zen 2, which comes at around 4 to 8 cores depending on which model you get. Ooh, all right.
Ooh.
So the CPU clock speed for that is around 0.4, which is the lowest, to 3.5 gigahertz, which is more than enough for you to play any game you want, all right?
Yeah. Here's the kicker. 16 gigs of RAM.
It has 16 gigs of LPDDR5 RAM at around 5,500 MT at a 32-bit quad channel, which is spicy, all right? Pretty good.
I have to say, the Steam Deck is kind of better than my laptop.
I mean, you can't really make that assumption because you can't really make that comparison because this is literally the like it's modern. Like this is like recent. So of course the tech's gonna be better.
You're complaining. It's like I'm complaining. Oh, my 3-year-old laptop is not as good as the latest and greatest. Like of course it won't.
Yeah, it's kind of like the same. That voice crack again. Sorry, viewers, for my voice crack. Hopefully. Make a piyok counter. Let's make a piyok counter.
Piyok.
It's at 2 now. All right. So for the GPU, it uses an AMD RDNA 2, which honestly I don't know much of AMD graphics, but from what I can tell from the developers themselves, they say that it's good enough that you can run Doom Eternal on high graphics, which is pretty good.
Let's move on to the other important specs.
The other important specs. We're going to talk about the display. This display is a 7-inch LCD touchscreen, and it's a touchscreen, mind you. So that means you're not confined to your little joysticks, all right? All right, the resolution is 1280 by 800, so it's at 800p, all right?
But 16 by 10.
Yeah, 16 by 10. The refresh rate is 60 Hz. Of course, it has stereo. It has stereo speakers, a 3.5mm jack, and dual mics. So that means you have mics on both ends that you can use to talk. And it even has a USB Type-C Bluetooth support for your Bluetooth headphones or earphones, right?
Yeah.
And also,
and get this, 45 watt USB Type-C charging. Let's go.
Yep. All right, now let's talk about the. Of course, it has Wi-Fi and Bluetooth support. I mean, every handheld should have that, honestly. Like, honestly, every handheld at this point should have that. All right, so how much does it weigh, though? Is it gonna be a dumbbell size where it's like 6 pounds? No. In fact, it is 1.47 pounds, which equates to 669 grams. All right.
Nice.
That's just for the console itself. So don't worry, it's not a giant brick that you have to log with you. Because it's light enough that you can carry it in the backpack or something.
Yeah. If you've ever held an iPad, it's kind of like the same thing.
Yeah, it's the same thing. But the good news is if you pre-order, like any of the models, doesn't matter which one, you're going to receive a carrying bag with it. All right, so that's a good thing. And also a case for it.
If only the other console came with it.
Yeah, if only the other console came with it. All right, so moving on. You tell me all of this stuff. All right, now let's move on to some actual reviews. For the review section, of course, we can't really say anything about it yet, like personally, because we don't own it. All right.
Yep.
So we're going.
We're only reporting on it.
We're only reporting on it. All right. So the question now is the Steam Deck any good? From Linus's video, he seemed pretty happy with it. And he's been, since I keep mentioning Doom Eternal as like a benchmark game for this console, it was because in the video of Linus Tech Tips, where he actually discusses the Steam Deck, he plays Doom Eternal a lot and a bunch of other games like Control, in order to just show us and to actually test for himself if the games can run well. And to no one's surprise, they absolutely do. Like they look great. Like a lot, they look really good, and they run at 60 FPS, which is great, right?
Wow, the new thing runs things really great. Wow.
Yep. But of course, there's always issues with the Steam Deck. Like, of course, there's always going to be issues. Well, main issue with the Steam. Well, honestly, there are a few issues, but I want to mention this one pro first before we get to the cons. The Steam Deck also has this anti-glare feature on its screen, like on its LCD screen. All right, to give you an idea of what that means is, you know, when you shine a light on your screen and it kind of reflects off of you, even though like you have it open. That's what screen glare is. It's just the light reflecting off of your monitor.
So it has anti-glare.
Yep, it has anti-glare because Linus literally flashed like a flashlight on the Steam Deck screen and also the Nintendo Switch's screen, and the Steam Deck barely had any glare. Like, it had almost no glare. So that's a good thing. So even if you're playing, and this is important, because if you're playing outside, it's much easier for you to look at your screen without upping the brightness as much.
And consuming more of your battery in the process. Yep. So really good.
Alright, now let's move on to the cons, alright? No good thing ever comes without problems, alright? So for the Steam Deck, much like any handheld, the problem lies with its battery, alright? The battery is the main problem I have with this thing. Because honestly, 2 hours, like, yeah, it's good that you can play for 2 hours, pretty good. That's more than you'll actually need. But for example, you download Final Fantasy 14 created by Square Enix on it, alright? Where grinds can take up to literal hours. I'm not joking. It, like, 2 hours is literally nothing if you play this MMO or any MMORPG for that matter. You will go by that 2 hours really, really fast and you won't notice it, alright? So I guess that's just more of like a little nitpick, is that 2 hours isn't really enough for people who if you plan to play it all day. So keep that in mind for the serious gamers with a capital G.
Have you ever heard of this game called
Final Fantasy 14? All right, enough Final Fantasy.
Just remember, it's 2 to 8 hours. We're only looking at the 2 hours at the minimum. It's because we're always assuming that the worst case scenario is that you'll be upping the brightness, you'll be playing at the most graphical intensive games. So let's manage expectations here.
Oh yeah, also another thing is that it's a lot bigger than the Nintendo Switch, alright? And so here's the thing that could be a problem if you don't have like a carrying case or if your backpack isn't big enough. It's pretty bulky, so do keep that in mind, that you have to have at least a case for it or a place for you to put it. Because the Steam Deck is a big boy, alright? It's a brick.
A big boy.
It's a brick that you'll log around with you, but just not as heavy, alright?
Yep.
And this is more of just, and here's another, well, is this really a con? Which is, it doesn't heat up as much as the, actually, no, that's not a con, that's a pro.
That's not a con, though.
Okay, so good thing about the Steam Deck, alright, I gotta move away for a bit because I forgot to mention it. The Steam Deck actually has really good onboard cooling. Like, it does not heat up as much, surprisingly, for what it's running. Because the cooling is just that much good. Like, that much better. Like, it's just really good. The cooling is that much great. Like, just that good. Alright? Ah, I'm stumbling on
my
words.
I mean, for a console, you expect it to.
Yeah.
And since it delivers, that's really great.
Yep, well, is it? Well, yeah, it's kind of a console, because all consoles are PCs, honestly. So, yeah, the cooling on the Steam Deck is really good. So you don't need to worry about it overheating, because it can handle its cooling very well, alright? To give you an idea, Linus ran like a, on his video, Linus ran like a temperature app on both consoles. The Nintendo Switch was, of course, obviously hotter, but the Steam Deck was barely hot. Like, it wasn't even hot, it was just a little warm, alright? After an hour of playtime. That's how good the cooling is. Pretty good, man. Alright, so, but of course there's gonna be caveats to this, which is, well, this is more of a nitpick than anything to its cooling system, but again, it's a general problem. But if you have your Switch for some reason in an enclosed space, oh wait, not your Switch, but your Steam Deck, like, left in a pretty humid room, it's going to heat up a lot more. But again, it's humidity, so don't sweat it
that much.
And also, if you keep this thing running, which I don't know why you'd do that, like running like in an enclosed space, of course it's gonna heat up a lot more than you would expect. But again, that's just a nitpick more than anything. It's not really something that anyone can control. All right, aside from that, like, that's all I can really say about the Steam Deck and the Nintendo Switch Pro, honestly.
Yeah, what I could just say is that going forward, handheld gaming is evolving. That's what I'm saying.
Yep, handheld gaming is just completely evolving. And hardware is leaning towards more of convenience nowadays. Because again...
Yeah, remember, mobile gaming on your phones, is a really big industry. So of course, it's natural that the were leaning more and more in towards handheld gaming because of it. And Steam Deck and, yes, also the OLED Switch is just products of that. Yep. And we're just ever grateful for it.
Yep. We're just grateful that at least, like, with this new tech innovations, there's going to be a lot better and more powerful handhelds in the future. Because, again, the core audience of this and its main appeal is that, you can take it with you on the go and you can have hundreds of games to play, considering your storage can handle it, all right? And again, it's not just for games. It's a portable gaming PC. So that means you can watch Netflix, you can watch videos, you can browse the internet, Facebook, go to Discord, anything you can think of that you would normally do with a PC, you can do here. Even crypto mining. I'm just kidding. All right? You didn't hear that from this podcast. I didn't say nothing. None of us said anything.
We didn't say anything. All right.
All right.
Anything else?
Anything else to add about the Steam Deck? Well, it's important to say that if anyone plans on watching Linus's video on the Steam Deck, remember that he explicitly says that this is an early build of the Steam Deck. It is not yet the released build, all right? And I can tell
you... Yeah, you have to wait for December 2021 for that.
I can tell you this, all right? What I've reported on like his experience and his review, and it was like on the early model of the Steam Deck, it runs really well for an early version, all right? And I can tell you this, when the release version finally comes, they say that they're going to run a lot of tests on the early version to make it a lot more optimized, a lot more powerful, and a lot easier to a lot easier for people to get into. So basically, they're going to make a lot of quality of life improvements as well as general improvements before they release it, obviously. But expect again, it's just Linus reviewed a early build of the Steam Deck. It's not yet the release build. And when the release build does drop, expect it to be a lot better, all right?
All right, so I guess that kind of does it for Steam Deck and the OLED Switch.
Oh yeah, now let's move on to the... Now, all right, speaking of audio, which honestly is important in gaming, let's move on to headphones, Roy. Let's actually move on to headphones, all right?
Let's do that. Yeah, let's go. What's our running time? Oh, 37 minutes. I guess we have to catch up.
It's pretty good. Pretty good, actually. Like 37 minutes. It's not that bad. All right. So, we're going to talk about headphones today. So, Roy, tell me, what do you know about headphones?
Your headphones.
Yeah, your headphones. Cup covers ear, noise go out.
Cup covers ear, noise go out. Earphones, smaller. Noise goes out anyway.
Yep. So
same thing.
Let's talk about how headphones actually work. All right. All right. If you're living under a rock and you don't know what headphones are, okay. Headphones are essentially these audio cups that go around your ear, like with a headband. That makes it so sound goes directly to your ears and you can listen to music good and audio stuff good, all right?
Yeah.
All right, so how do headphones actually work, all right? Of course, as mentioned before, the speaker drivers, like the actual speakers themselves, are enclosed in ear cups, which are like these suction things that clap around your ears. Huh? Clap, all right?
Clap.
All right. If there is a cover on the... All right, so this is important to note, all right, since we're going to talk about headphones. If there is a cover for the ear cups, like your entire ear is covered, that is considered a closed-back headphone, all right? If you see the speaker drivers, like you actually see the drivers themselves, like you're jotting out of it, that is considered an open-back headphone, all right? And I'll explain the difference of both a little later, all right? The sound coming from the closed-back bounces around the ear cup only, so that makes the music more compact. Essentially, you're just trapping the noise into your ear. All right.
Tugs,
now, if
go.
You have an open back, there is no boundaries. So it's literally like, okay, you know the speaker, the speakers that you would have on the side of your like PC or something. It's essentially that you take those PC speakers and tape it to your ears. Like that's a good comparison of what open backs are.
And get this, if you're outside and listening to your music on your open backs, people surrounding you will also hear it.
And also, I'd just like to say, I'd like to thank our wonderful researchers for coming up with these, like, earphones and headphones. Like, well, not earphones. Well, these models of headphones and the difference between open back and noise cancelling, all right? So thank you, researchers. It's really appreciated. All right.
Do you have any models to share? Or
of course, of course. Here? What? Of course. What kind of review? Well, not review. What kind of tech podcast would it be if I didn't mention any models? All right. Okay. So let's move on to the
Sony.
All right. Now let's move on to the open back headphones. All right, as mentioned before, open back headphones are when you can actually see the speaker drivers themselves kind of jutting out from the headphones, and it's more like having two speakers taped to your ears than anything. All right, so what makes open back good? All right, a good thing about the open back, it has a wider sound stage. All right, so that means like you get a bit more sound coming in, if that makes any sense. All right, and if you're listening to music, it feels like you're at a live performance, and it's actually a lot. That's not what it says. Okay, if you're listening to live performances like concerts, it feels a lot better. It feels like you're actually there. That's the magic of open back. Like if you're listening to live performances, concerts, or you name it, it feels like you're actually there from how they just work. All right.
Yeah, and just like that, People will also hear what you're listening to.
Yep, that's done that. See, I was getting to that, and honestly, you're right about that. The cons are pretty obvious, which is there's a lot of bleeding. So what does that mean? That means that your audio leaks out of your headphones because, again, it's open. The speaker drivers are exposed, so it's to be expected. All right? And it's not suitable if you want to take it out of the house, all right? Yeah, because honestly, if you're walking around school with an open back headphones, add another one to the piok meter, and you have open back headphones, like, dude, and you're listening to like Wheelie or something, like Doobie Doobie Dup Dup or something, people are gonna hear it. Or if you're even just listening to Shoddy's like a melody, people are gonna hear it because it's open back. Just remember.
Yeah.
So it's not really suitable for out of house listening, and it's only really useful. And it's only really usable if you're like at your own house, like in your own room or something, or if you have family members that don't really mind it. Just remember that, don't be rude and take this thing outside. Alright? So, okay.
Yeah, it's akin to putting your phone's music on speaker mode.
Yep.
And then at 50% volume.
Or if you're one of those people answering a call in speakerphone.
In public,
all right. Now let's move on. All right, so good open back headphones. A few models to name a few is the Philips SHP 9500. All right, if I remember, the researchers told me that Philips has always had good open back headphones, good quality, good prices. All right, or you can get the Hi-Fi Man HE 400 SE, which is also another good, open back headphones, or just get Sennheiser. All right. Sennheiser's been around for a long ass time, and they always have good quality open back headphones or even noise canceling headphones. Yeah. So, well, actually, Earl. No, not noise canceling. Yeah,
Earl, don't tempt me.
What? I'm just we're just reporting on facts here, man.
No, like I'm kind of tempted.
Hold on. Oh wait, sorry. Sennheiser doesn't have noise canceling headphones, as far as I know. All right. Based on the research, it just says here they have really good open back headphones, like good ones, alright? Just mwah, yeah. Cream of the crop.
I'm just saying, you talking about those Philips, you know, those good open backs for a cheap price, I'm like,
yeah, these are for really good prices, by the way, alright?
I was at this very moment, I was about to type Lazada.com.
Lazada.com. I gotta order it. Alright, so moving on. Open back, of course, there is such a thing as the duality of man. Alright? And speaking of duality, for every open back comes a noise cancelling. Alright? Oh, Sun Tzu said that. Alright, just kidding. I'm just kidding. For every open back, there is a noise cancelling. Sun Tzu's art of war. Okay, I'm kidding. Alright, so noise cancelling, as the name entails, are essentially just headphones that cancel noise and make it so that you don't really hear, like the sound doesn't leak as much, and you're only focused on the audio you're listening to. All right, so that's the difference between noise cancelling headphones with open back. All right, so noise cancelling headphones, there are two types of noise cancelling headphones. There's active noise cancelling and passive noise cancelling. All right, and here's the difference. All right. Passive noise cancelling comes with nearly all headphones, alright? all it really does is it blocks some of the sounds from the outside and inside of the headphones, all right? And what that essentially means is like, okay, it's like the one I have now, which is the Razer Black Shark 32. It's essentially just, if when you put them on, if you notice, it feels a little muffled, like any headphones with like a noise canceling.
Yeah, but doesn't it also use microphones?
Yep, yep. So, yeah. Yeah, it uses that. It also uses like, the Black Shark V2, I don't know a lot about it, but it does have passive noise canceling. And what it is just when you put a headphones around your ears and it's a little muffled, just a bit muffled, then yeah, that's noise canceling, right? Now, active noise canceling is a lot more fancier, actually, because it actually uses the onboard microphone to counter outside noise. So that means if, for example, you're playing Mobile Legends on PC or League of Legends on PC, tapos yung nanay mo nakatabi mo, sinisigawan ka kasi hindi, for some reason hindi ka naghugas ng pinggan. The microphone will pick that up and make your volume louder, essentially canceling out your mom yelling at you next to you. Alright?
So now you can epically play League of Legends for more hours on end.
Yup, until of course your mom, of course until pinatukan ka ng pinggan nanay mo. Pinatukan ka ng pinggan, di ba? Or ng chinelas kasi ayaw mo kainit. Alright?
Oops! All right. Internet say goodbye.
And the good thing about this is that it's better for traveling, especially if you're commuting. And this is from the personal experience from one of our researchers. I love you. Alright? So, his personal experience is that noise canceling is a lot better for commuting for obvious reasons, since the audio never leaks out unless you got it at like full blast, all right? But most of the time it doesn't leak. Like the audio isn't heard by anyone outside, all right? Only you can hear the audio. And also you can use it to just sort of pass the time. And if you don't really want, if you go to a crowded place where a lot of people are talking, you can use this to sort of drown out the noise.
Mm-hmm.
It's also, but of course, there's also the con that this can be more expensive since it's using technically more technology. And again, it's kind of like a little fancier than open back. So of course it's going to be a lot more, it's going to be expensive. Yeah. All right.
Of course, there is like a reason why people recommend the Sonys for air travel. Like I see it a lot. So
yeah, it's because like, you know, yeah, it's really good. Like, noise canceling headphones are really good for traveling because if there's a crying baby behind you, you can legit just pop on the headphones, all right? and just listen to music, all right?
Yeah, listen to beep 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 or sabi ng jeep for one hour.
Or listen to Jovit Baldivino remix, Jeepney remix. Wala ka ba ngayon sa aking pilit? All right, moving on. It has a lot of bass, which is good for hip hop or electronic music. Because more bass means that you'll get more sound fidelity. That means you'll be able to hear what the composer actually wants with the music. In other words, it just makes the audio better, all right? Because there's more bass. It's bassier.
You know, should we really be saying that more bass equals better?
I mean, look, in the terms of noise-canceling headphones, it is, all right? Because they handle it well. But if we're talking about the bass from speakers, like yung mga jeepney, yung sa likod ng mga jeepney pag nakokommute ka, that's a different story. Like the bass is so high that it causes the back seat to vibrate. That's my one experience. Like the actual speakers can't keep up with the bass because of how high the vibration is.
Do you not want that? Your jeepney is just vibrating all the way.
Yeah, let's go.
Let's go.
While listening to some remixes of popular songs. All right. So here are some brands of good noise canceling headphones. We have the Anker Soundcore Q20 or Q30. And again, all of the models I'm mentioning here are for a really good price, so be sure to check them out, alright? We have the Sony WH-1000X series, who, as mentioned, Roy, before, you said that Sony's really good for traveling, and there's actually a Sony brand here, which is pretty good.
And it's that specific model, mind you.
Yep.
It's used a lot in air travel. Alright.
We also have the Bose QC35 or the Bose 700, also really good noise-canceling headphones. Well, I do know a bit about Bose, and I can say that they have really good headphones, especially if you want the noise-canceling ones, because
They're just really expensive.
Yeah, they're just really expensive, except for these ones, actually. Like, the Bose QC35 or Bose 700, if I remember, like, they're not too bad. Like, they're pretty good for their price, honestly.
Like,
I couldn't say because I don't remember the exact prices and there's nothing written here in like the cheat sheet. So I just assume that they're gonna go for a good price, all right? They're gonna go for a good price, all right?
So I'm guessing between 15 to 20k.
Alright, so we have a little bit more time here. Like, we have like, what, 2 minutes? So to pass the time, before we pass it off to AJ, I just want to say that honestly, like, I would prefer noise cancelling over open back, because I don't want people to like hear what I'm doing personally, because that would be so embarrassing, dude. Imagine like you're watching an anime, and you know how animes get, like there's a lot of grunting, a lot of weird noises, and it just leaks out of your headphones, and it's just
imagine just hearing shouting for 30 minutes straight.
Exactly. Or if you're listening to music, imagine everyone has to hear it too, all right? Just imagine that. And a good thing about noise cancelling, as mentioned before, is that it just drowns out a lot of noise that would otherwise won't hear. Like, for example, if you're riding an MRT and there's a baby crying, just pop on the headphones and you don't have to worry about it. Or may nagsasapakan.
Let's just say.
Or may nagsasapakan sa labas ng bahay mo. Put on the headphones. Forget about it.
Let's just say, for travel, let's be responsible. Yep. Go noise cancelling.
Yep. Be responsible. Always make sure to adhere to etiquette, and remember, you aren't the only passenger on whatever you're riding, alright?
Yep.
Alright, so enough about that. I guess, well, that's all we have, honestly. That's all we have with all the games that you could play on. That's all we have on that, actually. Oh my god, I repeated myself 3 times. I'm so sorry, right? So, it's okay. So, not from phones or headphones. Not from things that would cost you a fortune to buy. This, honestly, I would say that this is a good place to pass it off. And that's a wrap for what yet again is another episode of Tech Talk. As always, we'd like to thank Jared Hortalesa for giving the background music, our researchers for giving us the info.
Well, I'd just like to say, knowing our runtime, I really hope that we don't go more than 1 hour and 10 minutes, because that would be kind of sad. I mean, it's nice, but it's kind of sad because we've been...
Yeah, it's kind of overshooting it. It's overshooting.
Because we're trying to reach a 1 hour only goal. So, you know, I mean, we can always make up for it on the next episode. So, Speaking of next episode, we hope you've enjoyed this episode about handheld consoles and open backs and closed back headphones. And because of that, Earl, I kind of want to buy...
You want to go shopping. All right, I'll send you the list. All right, I'll send you the list of what the researcher gave me. All right, honestly, I gotta thank Sergey. All right, I'm just gonna just say his name. All right, I gotta thank Sergey for providing the research for the headphones. It is very much appreciated. Thank you, man. All right.
And speaking of Sergey, I'll probably ask him about some monitors later on.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
He's the man with the plan. Yep. Right? So again, this has been Tech Talk, and that's all for now.
We'll see you next time.